Morning all. Thank you for joining us on Friday, 11 o'clock. So I'll be very, very brief. We've got Simon on today. I've known Simon for a long time. Some of you may have seen him on the Today program or listened to him on the Today program. So Simon, just by way of a brief introduction, author, podcaster, sports journalist. There's not much this man hasn't done, but what he has done is spent a fair few years, and Simon, you'll correct me, interviewing elite sports people, philosophers, psychologists, and really trying to dig deep. And Simon, just do sort of a bit of an introduction on what you have actually done, because I'm going to butcher it. But you're just looking at how you can live your life slightly more successfully, slightly happier, without losing yourself and without sort of... Have I done that right? Please, you will do a better job, obviously. Please introduce yourself.
Okay, thanks a lot, Andy. I was a sports reporter for Radio 1 from 2010 to 2018 and found sports probably a bit shallow and thought, there's that saying, sport is a metaphor for life, so I wanted to explore that. Launched a podcast on Radio 4 in 2018, in which I was using sport to explore life's bigger questions. And then that led to a book. And that the subtitle is What's Flummoxed Andy? And really, yes, the podcast series as a whole is very, very broad, but the book, I've narrowed down sort of 8 key themes. And I've moved now away from sport, but the book still is on sort of 8 key themes. And flow is really at the heart of it, and that's when we feel and perform at our best. And it's a state we seek all the time, whether we realize it or not. And Andy and I can get into that, but that I think that's a way.
Simon, first, that's probably the question. What is flow? And I know you can go very deep about it, but I'm relatively new to it. I'm sure there's at least a few people on the call that actually don't really know what flow is. Can you sort of explain it sort of almost in a really basic term, but then also in your slightly deeper version that people that
understand flow? Okay. So flow, first of all, is just very simply the state in which we feel and perform at our best. And like everyone is familiar with it to varying degrees, because if you think of, for example, having a chat with a friend or being at a party that's fun as opposed to a party you're not enjoying, and an hour goes by in what feels like 15 minutes, well, that is an example of flow to a degree, and there are gradations of it. Whereas obviously, you know, conversely, if you're at a party you can't stand or in a meeting that's really boring, or you're driving a long way with the kids in the back seat, the opposite happens and it feels like time drags. So flow is basically about being really, really engaged with what we're doing. And there's some really interesting stuff that goes on in the brain and in our experience. And it sort of begs the question as well, like, what is it that blocks it and how can we, you know, give ourselves the best chance of experiencing it, whether that be in our personal lives, but also obviously at work, like where it's most valuable. It was the term was coined by a guy called Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi in the 1970s, who studied loads of people. And then I've interviewed so many top performers. And when they talk about being in flow, first of all, it's this state that is gratifying for its own sake, unlike so much success. And obviously we all know that success element where we think we'll be happy and content and lastingly fulfilled when we get the house, the job, the pension, the retirement, etc., particularly the relationship, right? And it never works like that, or kids. And obviously in sport that's just heightened because it's something with so much more status, like a World Cup or a Grand Slam. And there are so many examples of people who've won these things and have experienced depression, a sense of lack, or at the very least, in my experience of having spoken to hundreds of these people, a sense of very quickly, is that it and what next? So success is frequently underwhelming, but flow is you can't be in flow and it not be enjoyable. And then at the same time, you perform at your best. So that's it in a nutshell. I hope that, you know, we can all relate to it, but we can go deeper because obviously when it comes to true performance, that's when you go to the next level.
And Simon, I suppose there's a flip side to flow, isn't there? I mean, it's the same side of the same coin.
I like to think of it in terms of like, why are we not getting into flow as much as we could? And I do think, I know burnout is a massive factor in that. So burnout obviously just means that sense of feeling like low energy, distracted, overwhelmed by work, et cetera, et cetera. You know, the stats are really, really high. They're going up all the time. And what they've shown is that if you have burnout on one side and flow on the other, as burnout goes up, your chance of getting in flow go down. But the interesting thing is that actually, if you can get in flow more, it can be act as a preventative measure against burnout. So what we want to do is reduce the burnout and increase the flow. Now, there are obviously multitude of reasons why people experience burnout. And I think the most important one to acknowledge is just the number of inputs we have now. Like I've got 5 email addresses. And on top of that, various social media accounts. And obviously we all have WhatsApp and texts and just so many inputs coming at us now. Whereas even 20 years ago, there was nowhere near. And go back 100 years and we get more inputs in a day, but certainly a week, than people got in a lifetime. And so our environment has massively changed, but our biology stayed the same. So there's a saying that I quite like, which is we have prehistoric brains in a futuristic world. And so it's about, okay, if we're getting all these inputs, what's that doing? Well, purely from a phone point of view, and I'm always very conscious of this. So I was, for example, in the gym yesterday. I nipped in there for lunch, and I really noticed this with young people in particular. Someone might be lifting a few weights, but they'll put the weights down and bang, straight on their phone. I was getting a train home after doing the Today program this morning, and again, just any down moment, people are straight like that, bush, onto the phone. And I understand it's hard, because I'm the same, like news is my Achilles heel. But the problem with that is twofold. Number one is we're training ourselves to be distracted. And number two, we are filling our conscious mind up with essentially useless information. And we can get onto why that's problematic in terms of flow specifically. But we're also continually shaking the snow globe. So we're keeping ourselves in that state of high alert, so burnout. So there are three things. It's like, how do we control the inputs that we are getting to reduce distraction, to reduce the amount of information that we're filling our minds up with, and to reduce being in this state of high alert to a greater or lesser extent? And obviously, there are broader cultural questions, but individually, just things like, you know, when you're getting a train, when you're queuing for something, making sure you're taking breaks, stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And putting the snow globe down, I think, is a really good way of just visualizing it. Factoring those in, it's so, so important, because you're never going to get near flow if you're permanently in this state of one thing to the next.
Simon, I think it was on one of your podcasts. I think it was really, really told me about it, where they did that study where they took someone's a group of people with IQs, all largely the same. Should I tell that?
I don't know the story you're talking about. So at least start it, Andy.
Yes. So basically, they took a group of people with zero IQ, split them into two groups, sent them off to do a project or a task, whatever it is. One group was distracted. I don't know how they distracted them. The other group was not distracted at all. Same project, same IQ largely. They then retested the people's IQs. And roughly speaking, there was a 10-point drop in the IQ standards of the people that were in the distracted group. So nothing different apart from they were distracted. And to give some context on that 10-point drop, and in no way am I recommending this, this is just what the study utilized. If someone was to smoke weed, there would be a 5-point drop on their I'm sure the bank would love me referring to that, but a 5-point drop in their IQ. And I just thought that's just that impact on actually just your IQ and your the ability of your brain to work. Surely on being distracted, which we all are. I'm sure it was unreal. Anyway, that for me.
No, I think you're right. It certainly does. That is a familiar story. I've heard it before, and it wasn't from you. So I'm pretty sure that was from one of my podcasts. Yeah, absolutely. Like, multitasking is a myth. They say women are better at it, but who knows, right? But we can't really do it. You know, you can actually only do one thing at a time. And what's quite interesting, particularly now for younger people with rises of things like ADHD, is the time it takes to get back on a task once you've been distracted. It takes like 20 minutes, 30 minutes in many cases. Mm-hmm. So jumping from one thing to the next is hugely problematic.
And also this the feeling of burnout, you know, where you're just all, this is a bit too much. We spoke about this in an offline sort of thing about how we're not doing any more than we used to. It just feels like it because we're probably over-distracted, over-stimulated, and we're just not very efficient, and therefore we don't get through as much as possible.
Absolutely.
I've also seen sat Stephanie from you about the impact on, you know, they did a study on executives and the... efficiency, is it?
Yeah. So, well, there's a couple of things to say to that. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've asked the question, for example, when doing talks, when was the last time someone was bored? And obviously the flippant answer is right now, but generally speaking, like, no one ever really has to be bored because, you know, you go for a drink with a friend, you go to the bar, turn around, bang, now they've got their phone out. And as I said, you know, the problem with this is we're training ourselves to be distracted and filling our minds up. So to bring it back to flow, the study you just were nodding to, Andy, was done by the McKinsey Institute, which they studied top executives over like 10 years and found that they could be up to 5 times more productive. And so the tagline that they attached to this was, well, if you spend Monday in flow, then you can basically take the rest of the week off. But, you know, it's about spending as much time in that as possible. And when I've spoken about flow with a lot of athletes, it's very interesting to hear them talk about, like, how they describe it, because they all describe it in the same way. So Johnny Wilkinson, when he kicked the winning drop goal for the World Cup, and by the way, if you're not interested in sport, don't worry, this is purely illustrative. I've got a bit of Albert Einstein in here too. Johnny Wilkinson, when he kicked the winning drop goal, he was like, it wasn't me kicking it, it was a knowing of it. Emma Raducanu, once she won the US Open, she was like, oh, it was insane. I was so in the moment. I wasn't thinking, my body was just acting. Frankie Dettori, remember when he had the best, when he nearly bankrupted all the bookies, it was like I was there, but I wasn't there. So there's this sense of sort of being there and not being there. And this is the really interesting thing about flow, is that normally our normal state of consciousness, you could say, is continually in psychological time. So we're always thinking, okay, for example, oh, I had a meeting yesterday, I wish I hadn't said that, or I've messed this up. And, you know, coming up, I've got this thing, and I've got my to-do list is really big. And if the thing that we're looking forward to psychologically, we're imagining is fun and perhaps exciting, you know, we will feel a similar sense of uplift. But if what we are imagining is fearful, then we will tend to feel anxious. And because of the negative bias of our minds, or the brain, which is just designed to keep us alive, we're drawn towards that latter one more. So we cause ourselves a lot of psychological suffering. So just a quick word on that. I mean, when people say, I'm scared of the unknown, it's like, you're not scared of the unknown. You're scared of your imagination about the future unknown. Like, there, you can't be scared actually of the unknown itself. But when we're in flow, we become so engaged with what we're doing that, like, our focus shifts down. And what happens is then thoughts automatically drop away about the past, which is why people say, in Johnny's case, say it wasn't me kicking it. Like, you only have an identity in terms of the type of person you are, the job you do, like everything about you in reference to the past, even if it's only 5 seconds ago in reference to the past. So that thoughts about the past drop away, but also thoughts about the future drop away, which mean that we don't have time to imagine a future that is either scary or exciting. We're just totally engaged with this moment. And that's why, you know, this sort of sense of timelessness or time distorting, which is one of the key traits of flow. But we have two parts of the brain, basically, just to add on at this point. We've got the default mode network, which I'm sure lots of you have heard about, which is basically the part of our brain. It's like the conscious part of our brain that we talk to ourselves about ourselves. So we all think about me. What do people think of me? How am I doing? Is my team better than their team? That job should have been mine. Like that. If we wake up stressed at 3 a.m. in the middle of the night, invariably our thoughts will be about me. I don't tend to wake up and worry too much about Andy's career, for example, at 3 in the morning. It tends to be far more my own, for example. But when you're in flow, this part of your brain, the default mode network where we're thinking about ourselves, goes offline. And this conscious part of our mind, it's very interesting because we tend to identify this as who we are. Like if I said to someone, do you choose your thoughts? Most people would say yes. But if you say to someone, do you also beat your heart? Well, no, obviously it just happens of its own accord, right? But it's the same intelligence, but on two kind of slightly different levels, because we've got the conscious attention, the conscious mind, and it's very weak, relatively speaking. So basically a study done in Harvard in the 1950s found that really we can only focus on around 5 on a good day bits of information at any one time or keep in mind. But the unconscious is just way, way more powerful, like 500,000 times more powerful. So it's got 100 trillion synaptic connections for starters. Its processor, if you think of it in computer terms, the conscious mind is 40 to 60 bits a second. The unconscious is closer to 2.5 million bits a second. So when we're in flow and we're so engaged with what we're doing, what's really nice is because those thoughts drop away and our sort of conscious mind drops away and there's that sense of our body just acting or we're just speaking without thinking and it's just happening and it just feels effortless. It's because the unconscious has taken over and is running the show. And it's so much more powerful. Because if you think of, as I said, beating our heart, digesting our food, all these things that our brain does to keep us alive, this conscious part of us, are not involved in 99.99% of them. And that's a blooming relief because if we were, we wouldn't last long. So it's tapping into, opening up to this deeper intelligence. And this is what happens in flow is this deeper intelligence is then allowed to come up and we perform in so much better. We're not thinking about myself and all this kind of stuff. Sorry, Andy.
We were talking about this yesterday. We were talking about how if you're doing a project, and guys, and obviously this is supposed to be a bit more of a sort of conversation booth rather than just some talking, even though I'm sure we're all happy with that. But when you're, for example, in the shower, you have your best thoughts. That's sort of, when you have about distractions. But we were talking about, Simon, when you've got that sort of unconscious, powerful computer essentially wearing away without you realizing it. When you're working on a project, and the first time I sit down and look at something and start writing a script or writing a presentation, it's rubbish. And I go away and I come back and suddenly I'm like, right, okay, that's better. And improve it. And then I'll go and have a break away from it again, come back. And every time I come back, it gets better. And you were sort of explaining why that happened. I know you just kind of covered it there, but it'd be really interesting to hear if people are connected with what Simon's saying and where they've had experience of engaging potentially with that.
To link it back to burnout, I just want to just so it makes sense to link those two things up. I said about the phones, right? We're training ourselves to be distracted and we're filling up with useless information. And then obviously there's the high alert, but those two bits. So first of all, flow follows focus. So Andy just said when he's working on this thing, right? But the key thing is if you can work on this thing for an extended period of time. So when I was writing my book, I did 3 hours in the morning. And then I would have a break and I would go for a swim. And that's when the unconscious mind would be whirring away. And I'd come back. And a lot of the stuff I was like, I have no idea what I'm going to write. It would have been worked out for me by this deeper intelligence. So that focus bit, being able to not
to focus on one thing at a time, not be replying to emails, not having WhatsApp, all that. It's so important to the focus. And I just wanted to use the Einstein quote, which is, I think this sums it up brilliantly. I think 99 times and I find nothing. I stop thinking, I swim in silence, and the truth comes to me. So that's an Albert Einstein quote. So it's about, as I said, focus and embracing stillness and these breaks to allow the more powerful part of the mind to come up and share its creativity.
Sorry, Andrew, you're in a...
I was going to say that probably none of the professional sports stars on the call, but for us, how important is exercise and possibly reading a book, not reading something on an iPad, but physically reading a book? I see you've got quite a few books behind you. Because books you tend to focus on and cut out the noise, and exercise is, I personally do zone out when I'm exercising. Maybe I reach that flow state, maybe I don't, but I wondered how important they are in helping you.
That's such a good question and so important, and you're absolutely spot on. So I'm exactly the same. Those two examples you've given are my absolute go-tos for switching off would be exercise, particularly so cardio, like swimming. I think it's such a good one for me. And then reading, because it does engage you. But as I said, most people now in those moments of, oh, I'm going to have a break, come to this. And all they're then doing is, you know, you're basically flipping from one thing to the next. So yes, choosing a quality break, like you just said there, is absolutely fundamental to give the space for your unconscious to kick into action, because it's one thing, it's engaging the mind and it's slowing it down rather than filling it up with a whole load of new stuff or jumping from one thing to the next. So that absolutely spot on.
I just had an example, one thing that made me think about in terms of distraction. But I remember many years ago doing a sea survival course, and we were in a swimming pool and we were all hauling each other into a life raft, which was great fun. It was nice and warm in the swimming pool. We were all having a great laugh. And the last occasion we did it, the instructor got a hose and sprayed us with cold water. And that was not fun. And it made it much more serious. And it brought home to us the fact that we were all having a good laugh in the swimming pool. And now, okay, so suddenly this is serious. And that was a complete distraction that took us away from having a great time to having something somewhat less than a great time.
Yeah. Yeah. Does anyone else resonate though with that? Sorry, Andy, I'll butt in. I can see with that kind of, you can go to bed thinking about something, go, oh, I can't get an answer. And then you wake up in the morning and it's just all sorted for you. Or you get your best ideas in the shower. Or, when I used to work at Radio 1 and we used to have to come up with creative radio treatments, it was like we'd have the meeting and then it would be go away, have a coffee, go and do go away, have a chat, whatever. And that's when the idea would come, not when you're sitting there like, argh. And what I find is, this is what I found when I write my book, a phrase I quite like is mistrust your sense of urgency, because I would have this, I'd set myself a word limit and then I would not be getting there at about lunchtime. And then my mind would be going, well, you can't stop because you haven't got there yet. But actually, as a sign to stop, to do exercise in particular, because you're getting rid of some of the stress hormones too, because that's where the breakthrough comes. If you're just trying to plow through it, you just butting your head against the wall. I just wondered if anyone else sort of resonated with that in their own lives.
I agree that sometimes if there's a sort of complicated thing that I need to think about, often I'll put it down and, the answer will come to me like a day later, 2 days later, maybe. It does come to you if you leave it.
Yeah.
When, obviously not for urgent things, that's not too urgent, but I don't tend to do urgent stuff. But it's better if you leave it and think it comes to you.
Yeah. I find that as well, Sarah, the ability to problem solve when I'm not sat in front of the problem.
Yes.
So when I'm taken away from it. But also I recognise the impact on my ability to concentrate now that I'm so used to using phones and everything else is so much shorter. Yeah. And I really struggle to sit for long amounts of time to focus on something that, something I need to draft and I find that really frustrating because I just want to get that task done. Mm. But my ability to concentrate and stick at it is shot, I feel, that maybe it's just the blame of like using like phones or something else. But I think that's probably a product of our kind of society now in terms of that. Even watching a television program, and my husband will be like, "Will you just put your phone down?" And it's just that forever, like, skitting around different things, being stimulated by so much that you just can't even just sit to watch a television program or a film or something, because my concentration won't stick for that long.
Well, is that?
Yeah. Sometimes like, I do make a conscious effort to, I'll say, right, I'm not going to look at my phone now, and I'll put it to, I'll silence it, put it to one side and just not look at it. But I have to make a conscious effort not to.
You know, can I just show you something that might help? Bear with me one second. So I have a mobile phone locking case. Because the thing is, it's all very well and saying, you know, oh, I'm not going to look. And obviously there are days when our willpower is higher. But I, for example, if I'm tired, that's when I know I'm most susceptible. And so, for example, what I've started doing now is if I'm doing deep work, so if I'm working on something, I think, right, I don't want to be interrupted. I'll put my phone in here for 3 hours, turn everything off, put earplugs in and work on it. So that's number one. Number two would be in those moments, number two, when I go inside at the end of the working day now, I switch my phone off because I used to use it to listen to comedy when cooking to get respite from like the family and kids or whatever else. And that was like a special time. And I was like, I don't want to lose that. So what I'm now using an old laptop to do the same thing, but obviously I'm much more limited. But so I think actually, so there's a saying from one of my podcasts, which is that our willpower is weak, but our design power is strong, which is why, like, I'm the last person in our house who will order chocolate. But I'll tell you what, I'm the first one who will eat it if it's here. So, like, it's just don't have it in the house or put in these barriers to difficulty. And then the one other thing I'd say would be is it's stretching your attention. So, and the great opportunities to these, there are opportunities to these. For example, on the train on the way home just now from London after the Today program train, great example. It's literally just sitting there and factoring these moments that are there, switch phone up and just sit. And whether there might be following your breath, it might be looking out the window, whatever it is, but we've got to find ways to stretch our attention back out. I'm quite lucky doing podcasts because I'll talk for 2 hours, which is very fortunate, which is it. But reading a book is another one, like reading a book for half an hour, 40 minutes, anything where you're stretching your attention. But I would just say, get that phone and lock it away. You know,
you're very pro then, Andrew, all the TED teachers locking student phones up. You presume that works.
Well, I said earlier, this is a different topic, really, but sort of children, phone, social media is a different thing, but connected. Social media for 16-year-olds and below.
And the momentum in this country is going wild. Smartphone-free childhood, it's absolutely flying. I mean, it's a matter of time before it's banned for the under-16s, I think. And then, okay, what impact then on parents? You know, it's definitely going to change. So it's like we've got to do something about it in the meantime because they're designed to be addictive.
But what I find frustrating is sometimes when you're out, you will see parents with children and you know, children, not adult children, and the parents are on their phones.
You just think,
you know, this is so it's all very well taking the kids' phones off them, but if the parents won't take to them.
Yeah, it was going to say not about their
training. Also handing phones down to 2-year-olds.
Yeah.
We've told our eldest she's not getting a phone until she's 16. And even by then, and she's 9 now. And by then, hopefully, it will be completely different anyway. Because I do think that there's a real backlash building.
My 11-year-old has a brick phone, and that's enough. She takes pictures, she makes calls, she texts. That's the only thing a phone is supposed to be doing for such young brains. And I think it affects us very badly in terms of our mental health, our concentration span, as we've just seen. So I think that we need to also rethink our own use. And I think it's brilliant that you should have one of those cases where you actually can't get into the phone, even if you want to. You have to break it to get into it until you know, such time. I was actually shocked to realize that smartphones were only available since 2007.
Yeah.
Let alone we put Blackberries on the side. So we've only had 17 years of that, and look how hooked we're all with them.
No, yeah, I completely. It's like cigarettes, right? Except it's for mental health. I see it in that way. Sorry, in answer to your question, Andrew, it was smartphones. No way she's getting anywhere near that till 16. Dumb phones, like, great. You know,
Snake on a Nokia.
Yeah, like, you know, cool. I'd need a map on it because I'm useless to that kind of things. And so with the come of the basics, I'd love to get back to that. You know, people don't speak now, for example, you know.
We are sort of out of time. So Simon, just on the flow piece, because actually we're sort of skirting into different topics, which are really important, but
it is very much related. Yeah.
Yeah, really, absolutely. If you were just to do a sort of a bullet point summary of what we've spoken about, and then what I'll do, if it's all right, Simon, can you send some of your podcasts that are specifically focused, and I'll ping it to everyone that's tuned in?
As long as everyone promises to rate it on wherever they listen, then of course.
There we go.
And don't forget, there's the book where this is all laid out. Yes, so just in a nutshell, just remembering, I think, that burnout and flow are diametrically opposite. And so, you know, if we can get in flow more, then we reduce the symptoms of burnout. And then in terms of what we can do individually, it's what we've just been talking about in terms of phones, reducing the inputs, but that could also be email and stuff like that as well. And you'll have a certain time when, you know, I will answer email or whatever it may be, because we don't want to be training ourselves to be distracted, and we don't want to be filling up our conscious mind with stuff, which you can think of as like a letterbox into the unconscious. So keeping that inner space as clear as possible. And then work, flow follows focus. So focusing on one project rather than jumping from one to the other, where possible, for a long period of time, or for an extended period of time. So obviously that's not always possible. And then actually a good sign is when you start to feel frustrated, because that's actually showing you that that's when we want to distract ourselves, but actually it's a good sign. And then going for a break, but a proper break, as we've discussed, a book, exercise in particular, getting rid of some of that, allowing the unconscious mind, which is 500,000 times more powerful, to come in, and then coming back to the problem and focusing again without distractions and allowing it to come through. So that's really it in a nutshell. It's actually pretty simple, but it's about just creating the conditions in which this can happen, because the very thing that we tend to believe is us, this conscious mind, is the very it can't force its way in there, because that is the very thing that has to go for flow to emerge. That's the kind of paradox. All you can do is create the conditions and then allow this to kind of rise up through us, as it were.
Guys, if anyone's got a quick question, we could probably do that. If not, I will do a little closing bit just about the information I'll send afterwards. But does anyone have a question? Anyone think there's something interesting? There's a couple of things on the messages. Taking a break, going, making a glass, a cup of coffee, or having a glass of water just 5 minutes away helps me to refocus. And just some examples of the things people do, like DD, I think you said, art, drawing, gardening. Yes, it's even going for a walk, right? Yeah. That could be enough.
Anything that we find enjoyable for its own sake that stops us, you know, ruminating about the past and imagining the future. Kind of mini flow to get into flow around focused attention on what we want to do.
Yeah, thank you. Right, so I will send a bullet point of what Simon's just covered there at the end, plus a link to, he's going to send me the podcast specific on flow. I'll also send a link to his book, which is really good. I've read it. I've actually got a couple of copies on my desk. It is a good read, and it is really helpful for me, just sort of almost just processing sort of things you kind of think you know, if you maybe not. That's how it's been quite useful for myself anyway. Simon, as always, thank you very much. I could listen to you talk about this sort of stuff almost on repeat. So I hope everyone else feels the same. But
Oh, kind of, yeah.
Thank you very much.
See you, Andy.
Cheers, Simon. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I really enjoyed that.
Thank you. Thank you very much.